returns, and even more returns 20 years ago as the World Wrestling Federation presents Royal Rumble 2002, taking place on January 20th, 2002, taking place at the Phillips Arena in Atlanta, Georgia, now known as the State Farm Arena. The attendance for this show is a sellout 12,915. The live gate for this show is $859,690, and the pay-per-view buys for this show was $665,000, making this the most bought Royal Rumble of all time. Compared to the numbers from Royal Rumble 2001, 2002 was lower than 2001 in attendance, but 2002 was higher than 2001 in both live gate and pay-per-view buys. Compared to the numbers for the rest of the WWF E pay-per-views in 2002, Royal Rumble was 5th lowest in attendance, with Armageddon being the lowest, Royal Rumble was 6th highest in live gate, WrestleMania being the highest, and Royal Rumble was 2nd highest in pay-per-view buys, with WrestleMania being the highest as well. So while attendance and live gate wasn't the greatest, they did amazing in pay-per-view buys, which pay-per-view buys for WWF pay-per-views hadn't been doing that great since WrestleMania the year prior. Your commentators for the night were Jim Ross and Jerry the King Lawler. No dark match or pre-show match on the night, so on to the main show itself. 6 total matches, 4 title matches, a street fight, and the 30-man Royal Rumble match itself. And we kick things off for Royal Rumble 2002 with match number 1. It was the first of 4 championship matches on the night. This one was for the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Championships. Champions Taz and Spike Dudley versus challengers Bubba Ray and D-Von, the Dudley Boys. Taz and Spike Dudley were in their first reigns as tag team champions, defeating the Dudley Boys on the January 7th, 2002 episode of Monday Night Raw. Spike had been feuding with his kayfabe brother since the spring of 2001, during which time he formed many different makeshift tag teams in order to beat Bubba and D-Von, each time with no success. But finally, earlier in the month, he and Taz not only defeated the Dudleys, but they won the tag team championships in a hardcore match, leading to a rematch here at the Rumble. I'd almost forgotten that not only did Taz and Spike Dudley form a tag team, but they were also the tag team champions. The only reason I think they were a team was due to them being ECW alums, and that was it. Spike was entering this match with a neck brace. There was a theme for the first half of Royal Rumble 2002, and that was the matches weren't the longest in the world. This opener for the Tag Team Championships was only a 5-minute match, but for a 5-minute opener, it was an okay. For what the time they had, it was never boring, and they made the best of the time given. Dudleys would work Spike over for a while, Taz came in like a house of fire for the comeback, and eventually Taz made D-Von submit to the Taz mission for the win as Taz and Spike Dudley defeated the Dudley Boys in 5 minutes 6 seconds to retain the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Championships. Next up was match number 2. This was the second of 4 championship matches on the night, and this one was for the World Wrestling Federation Intercontinental Championship. Champion Edge versus challenger William Regal. Edge was in his 4th reign as Intercontinental Champion, defeating Test at Survivor Series 2001. The feud between Edge and William Regal went back to the end of the prior year, with Edge retaining the Intercontinental title against Regal at Vengeance. During this feud, Regal had introduced the brass knuckles to his arsenal, or as he called it, the power of the punch. Pull the knuckles out of the trunks, use them, put them back, and the match is over. It had become so infamous that eventually referees were starting to catch on. They would search him before matches, couldn't find him, still use him. The referee here was smart because he searched everywhere, including Regal's trunks, where Regal was caught red-handed with the brass knuckles. Knuckles out of play, the match begins, and it was longer than the prior match, but still under 10 minutes, but didn't really matter. Really good match between Edge and Regal for the Intercontinental title, and looking back, the very underrated program for both guys. For Edge, it was really his first program that didn't involve Christian in some form or fashion. For Regal, it added something to him that was more than just wrestling. The power of the punch gimmick was fantastic. Great back and forth, Edge with the flashier offense, while Regal had the more rough, rugged offense. And in a great heel finish, Regal pulls out a second pair of brass knuckles while Edge goes for the spear. Regal pulls the ref in front of him to take the spear. Regal hits Edge with the power of the punch to win and become the new champion, as William Regal defeated Edge in 9 minutes 45 seconds to win the World Wrestling Federation Intercontinental Championship. After that, match number 3 was the third of 4 championship matches on the night. This one was for the World Wrestling Federation Women's Championship, with Jacqueline as the special referee. Champion Trish Stratus versus challenger Jazz. Trish Stratus was in her first reign as women's champion, winning a 6-pack challenge at Survivor Series 2001. Jazz would make her WWF debut during that 6-pack challenge at the Survivor Series, and ever since her debut, she had been chasing Trish and the women's championship. In the lead-up to this match, Jazz injured Trish's hand, hence the tape on her hand. This would end up being the shortest match of the night at under 5 minutes. All things considered, not completely terrible, I wouldn't call it great or anything, but not bad either. They did a lot in the short amount of time they were given. Jazz with her offense on Trish, Jazz and Jacqueline have a confrontation, Trish makes her comeback, near fall after near fall, and then in the end, Trish hits Jazz with a bulldog to end the match, as Trish Stratus defeated Jazz in 3 minutes 43 seconds, to retain the World Wrestling Federation Women's Championship. Match number 4 was a street fight, Ric Flair versus Vince McMahon. The night after Survivor Series 2001, Ric Flair made his return to the World Wrestling Federation. He said that Shane and Stephanie sold their company stock to a consortium in order to run the alliance. The consortium ended up being himself, Ric Flair, making Vince and Flair 50-50 owners of the WWF. Near the end of the year, the two had a segment on an episode of SmackDown when Flair goes through their history together, bringing up 1988, 1991, Royal Rumble 92, WrestleMania 8, and it goes on. He does one of his big yelling promos, and then he brings up going through all the different WWF contracts. Then he saw one that said, Vince McMahon, owner slash wrestler. And at the Royal Rumble, it was going to be Vince McMahon versus Ric Flair in a match. This would be Flair's first match since the final Nitro the March prior, and his first televised WWF match since the Loser Leaves Town match against Mr. Perfect on Raw in January 1993. You also had in the build Vince mocking Flair with the wig and the robe, culminating in Vince hitting Flair with a lead pipe. This was made a street fight, and it was a street fight for 2 reasons. 1, you had to smoke and mirrors it with Vince, and 2, Flair was having a lot of confidence issues at this time. Shoot-wise, Flair didn't want to wrestle again. The last little bit of time in WCW killed his confidence. But Vince's reaction to him about having this match with him gave him a little bit of that confidence back. These two, smoke and mirrors and all, put on a hell of a street fight for 2 guys in their 50s, Vince 56, Flair 52, you can't ask for anything better. For maybe the only time ever, correct me if I'm wrong, Vince McMahon controlled a match. No shit, it was about 90% offense Vince, when typically Vince is taking an ass-kicking 99% of the match. He outpowered Flair, he used weapons on Flair, busted Flair open before he was busted open, even applied the figure 4 on Flair. But eventually Flair started making his comeback, he rallied, he busted Vince open, he cracked Vince with the pipe, figure 4, and Vince tapped out, as Ric Flair defeated Vince McMahon in 14 minutes, 55 seconds. Next up was the penultimate match of Royal Rumble 2002, match number 5, and it was the fourth and final championship match of the night. This one was for the undisputed World Wrestling Federation Championship, champion Chris Jericho versus challenger The Rock. Chris Jericho was in his first reign as World Wrestling Federation champion, defeating Steve Austin at Vengeance 2001, unifying the WWF and WCW championships. Yes, Chris Jericho defeated The Rock and Steve Austin in the same night to win and unify the WWF and WCW championships, becoming the first undisputed world champion stateside in many decades. But the feud between Jericho and The Rock predates the whole undisputed title saga, as these two had been feuding since the fall of 2001 when Jericho and The Rock started getting sick of each other's shit. Jericho beat Rock for the WCW title in October at No Mercy, before The Rock retained it weeks later, and the two even won the tag team championships for a brief period of time. Rock became number one contender for the Undisputed title by defeating Booker T in early January on SmackDown, leading to this match here at the Rumble with Jericho. Rock and Jericho faced each other many times since October the prior year, and I can't name a bad match these two had against each other. There was something about these two combined their promos and in the ring that clicked great. Amazing chemistry between Rock and Jericho. The match here at the Rumble was no different than their past encounters. Another great match. Loved how Jericho was the only guy to ever defy The Rock, put his hand in Rock's face, and go just bring it to The Rock. And bring it he did. Amazing work from these two. Eventually, Rock would get a sharpshooter in. It looked like The Rock won, but Lance Storm and Christian distracted the referee. Jericho hit a rock bottom. Rock hit a rock bottom through the announce table. Kickouts from each respectively. Escape from submissions. More near falls. Shady referee Nick Patrick refuses to count for The Rock, which resulted in Rock attacking him. Rock had the match won for a second time when he hit the people's elbow, but no referee to count. Finally, a low blow using the exposed turnbuckle and a roll-up with the feet on the ropes. Jericho got the 3 count to retain as Chris Jericho defeated The Rock in 18 minutes, 48 seconds, to retain the undisputed World Wrestling Federation Championship. With 5 matches down and 1 more match to go, it's time for match number 6 and the main event of Royal Rumble 2002, the 30-man Royal Rumble match. Winner gets a shot at the undisputed World Wrestling Federation champion at WrestleMania 18. The participants in this match are Al Snow, Albert, Big Boss Man, Billy, Booker T, Bradshaw, Christian, Chuck, Diamond Dallas Page, Farouk, Goldust, Jeff Hardy, Kane, Kurt Angle, Lance Storm, Matt Hardy, Maven, Mr. Perfect, Perry Saturn, Rikishi, Rob Van Dam, Scotty Too Hotty, Steve Austin, Test, The Big Show, The Godfather, The Hurricane, The Undertaker, Triple H, and Val Venus. The main story heading into this Rumble was all the returns happening during the match. The big one, of course, was the return of Triple H. He had been out injured with a quad tear since late May. He returned on the January 7th episode of Raw to a loud ovation in MSG in one of Raw's all-time best moments. He made his intentions known. He was going to be in the Royal Rumble match. You also had 4 other returns here advertised in the build-up to the show: Mr. Perfect, Goldust, Godfather, and Val Venus. Henning hadn't been in the WWF since 1996, he hadn't had a match in the WWF since 1993, and he'd been doing his own thing since his WCW tenure was done. Dustin hadn't been in the WWF since 1999, he was in WCW, had one of those AOL Time Warner contracts, were sitting at home with that, eventually that contract was bought out. With Godfather and Val Venus, They were sitting at home because the company had nothing for them after the Right to Censor breakup, so might as well sit them at home, eventually bring them back as their old characters. There's a lot of intrigue with these returns, but you also had the big potential encounters during this match. Austin and Triple H was the one highly anticipated one, but you also throw Kurt Angle in one of these, you throw Undertaker in one of these, and speaking of those four, Steve Austin, Triple H, Kurt Angle, and The Undertaker, those were the four favorites to win this match heading into the 2002 Rumble. After the rules rundown, it was on to the Royal Rumble match. Number one was Rikishi, number two was Goldust, number three was Big Boss Man, number four was Bradshaw, and shortly after, the Boss Man was eliminated. Number five was Lance Storm, number six was Al Snow, and number seven was Billy. Not long after that entrance, Lance Storm was eliminated, and then number eight, The Undertaker. All about respect and fuck everybody else, he eliminated the four men remaining. He was all alone in the ring. Matt Hardy came out at number 9, Jeff Hardy came out at number 10, Taker had destroyed both Hardys and Lita during the build to this match, so they wanted their revenge, but Undertaker eliminated both Hardys and was all alone in the ring once again. Number 11 was Tough Enough One Winner Maven, and it was stopwatch time until the Hardys interfered after already being eliminated. Taker beat them up, eliminated them again, and Taker told them to get their ass out of his ring. And then, you had one of the Royal Rumble's most shocking moments ever, as Tough Enough rookie Maven drop-kicked and eliminated The Undertaker from the Royal Rumble match. The crowd reaction and JR's call will live forever in Royal Rumble lore. Then reality struck, because Undertaker destroyed Maven, eliminated him from the match, he attacked number 12 Scotty Tuhati before he could even enter, Christian entered at number 13 while Taker attacked Maven all the way to the concessions, putting him through the popcorn machine. Scotty would finally get into the match. Soon after, Diamond Dallas Page was out at number 14, and soon after that, Scotty was eliminated. Chuck was out at number 15, then the Godfather was out at number 16. He had one of the coolest and longest entrances in Royal Rumble history, bringing out 12 of his ladies. During the entrances when DDP was eliminated, Albert came out at number 17 and he was soon eliminated. Godfather was eliminated after that. Perry Saturn was out at number 18, then the Iron Man of the 2002 Royal Rumble came out at number 19, Stone Cold Steve Austin. All three in the ring were eliminated by Austin, and for good measures, Chuck and Christian were eliminated a second time by Austin. You get a callback to 1997 with Austin looking at his watch. Number 20 was Val Venus. Number 21 was Test. Both eliminated by Austin. And once again, Austin was all alone in the ring. Then number 22 came out. It was Triple H. This was the moment being built for this whole Rumble match, and it delivered. The Hurricane was out at number 23, he was quickly eliminated after trying a double chokeslam, Farouk was out at number 24, he was gone within seconds, then number 25 was Mr. Perfect, he came out to a loud ovation, Kurt Angle number 26, number 27 Big Show, number 28 Kane, Big Show eliminated, then Kane eliminated, number 29 Rob Van Dam, and number 30 Booker T. Now down to the final six, and what a final six this was. You had six Hall of Famers left in the match. RVD eliminated by Booker T, then Booker T eliminated by Austin, which was Austin's 36th career Royal Rumble elimination, the then record for the match, leaving a final four of Triple H, Steve Austin, Mr. Perfect, and Kurt Angle. While Austin was trying to eliminate Perfect, Angle came from behind to eliminate him. Afterwards, Austin attacked everyone with a steel chair. Angle tried to eliminate Triple H, but caught Perfect with a clothesline, leading to an eventual Mr. Perfect elimination from Triple H. The final two was Kurt Angle and Triple H. Angle thinks he eliminated Triple H, but then a facebuster and a clothesline led to Angle's elimination as Triple H won the 2002 Royal Rumble match, last eliminating Kurt Angle in 1 hour, 9 minutes, 22 seconds, the longest 30-man Royal Rumble match ever, has only been surpassed twice, first by the 40-man Royal Rumble in 2011, and then the 30-woman Royal Rumble in 2019. Royal Rumble 2002 is all about the final three matches of the night: the street fight, the WWF title match, and the Royal Rumble match itself. I'm not saying the first half of the show is bad, however, you could really skip the first half, get right into the show starting with the street fight. The Rumble match itself is a really good one. Yes, Triple H winning was predictable, but to be fair, so was every other Rumble match from 1996 until 2006, minus 1997. Predictability didn't ruin this, and neither did announcing the returns in advance. What a difference 20 years makes. Then you announce returns and fans get excited, now you announce returns and it's, quote, spoiling and ruining the match, but whatever. Overall, would I recommend Royal Rumble 2002? Yes, I would. Now on to the Golden Ring Bell and Brown Ring Bell for WWF Royal Rumble 2002. I give the Golden Ring Bell for best match to Chris Jericho versus The Rock, and I give the Brown Ring Bell for worst match to Trish Stratus versus Jazz. But those are just my thoughts. What about you? Share your thoughts on Royal Rumble 2002 in the comment section below. Ask questions about the show, what was your favorite and least favorite match on the night, and was Maven eliminating The Undertaker the most shocking elimination in Royal Rumble match history? Until next time, peace.
It's the interview queen, Alicia Tu, and I would like to introduce you all to From the Vault, a weekly wrestling discussion hosted by James over on We Are Pro Wrestling on YouTube. Since 2017, From the Vault has covered various wrestling topics from the past, like pay-per-views, wrestler retrospectives, and much, much more. Make sure to subscribe and click the notification bell. Whatever episode you're actually listening to, whether current or archived, don't forget to like, comment, and share. And last but not least, like him on Facebook, follow him on Twitter, be sure to support, because you will get tons of updates on future episodes there. All links are down below, so what are you waiting for? Go enjoy. Bye!